All right, welcome to how to write an epic battle scene, or even just a good fist fight. I'm going to ask some questions. So I'm going to have a little bit of candy, and we'll see if I can aim very good. All right, and if you know the answer, or have a suggestion or a comment, raise your hand, and then I will actually repeat what you say. So the others can hear, and also so the camera can hear what your comment was. So it's not because I have issues. All right, so that's why I'm going to probably repeat everything you say, at least I hope to. All right, the fight. Have you ever read a book that doesn't have some sort of fight, either physical or maybe like an emotional one, like some, yeah. You have. He says he has. Did you like it? Okay, he didn't really like it. Oh, you have two?
How about the dictionary?
I should say a novel. So what does the fight serve? Why is there always a fight? Hang on, let me get my treats. Leather jacket right there. There must be opposition in all things. All right, I'm going to try. That was so bad. This is heavier. Here we go. I'm going to ask people on the photo, I think. All right, another reason. Yes, right there with the blue shirt on. Yeah, well, blue. Yeah. Excitement. Excellent. The sweethearts don't work very well. All right, we'll take another one right up here. Really? All right. That is probably true. We tend to get in conflicts a lot, and that's pretty obvious. We'll take one more. Yeah, it's the conflict that really, it engages your readers. So, but you just write it to have conflict. We're gonna talk a little bit about why you might write. Why put a fight into your book? First of all, entertain, and that someone mentioned that, okay. Next of all, create conflict. You guys are so smart. You were like top two answers. The next one we didn't mention in here, and that is to show the struggle between two characters. So if it's a romance book, you'll probably show a struggle between the girl and the boy at some point. If it is a fantasy book, you will probably show a struggle between probably good and bad, okay? Whichever nation portrays good, whichever one does bad. So a struggle between characters. Battles also move your plot forward. They help you, they can get to, so you've got your battle, and that will propel you. It'll kind of create the why for the next scene, okay? Maybe the next scene will be some people mourning over the battle, okay? Because some bad things happen during it. So it propels your plot forward. You put important people in your story, so your protagonist, you put them at stake. If it's not your protagonist, a person, at least you put something important, a theme, like freedom, okay? So a battle will put your protagonist or another important character at stake, as well as, or perhaps it's just a thing. A battle helps resolve problems. Do your parents ever fight? All right, I fight with my husband, let's just be honest. Sometimes getting in that fight is what you need to then resolve the problem. And it's the same way in your book. And then someone did mention this right up front. She said that they like it, and it is true that fights and conflict are part of the human experience. So we're going to talk about five types of fights. Realistic, fantasy, one-on-one, one-on-many, and epic. And I'll give you a minute to write those down if you want. A lot of you are probably interested in a fantasy fight, right? In a fantasy book. A lot of you maybe write some fantasy. Okay. A realistic fight, you'd for sure find in contemporary fiction, which is like every day happens. It's a normal world, normal kids, normal people. However, you can have a realistic fight in a fantasy novel. That means If it's just two people arguing over what they're going to have for dinner, that's a realistic fight. And it could be in a fantasy novel, okay? But also in a fantasy novel, you up the ante because there's going to be something else added. And we'll talk about that. Now, the other three fights, you've got one-on-one, that's obvious. Obvious kind of fight. One-on-many is a little trickier to write. And then epic is your hardest. We're going to see an example of a realistic fight, okay?
Brett and Dave were arguing in the other room.
Fact! Brett, I had a class. You don't know what you're talking about.
Fact.
Oceanology.
Oceanography.
Oceanology.
Oceanography.
Fact!
Ow!
And their dad got in the car and he said,
"All right. I've been so excited to spend some time with you guys.
This gonna be fun.
Frick!
It's called oceanology.
Frick!
Shut up, Rick. Really.
Frick!
She has short hair like a boy, but she's a girl.
Hey, Dave, what's oceanography?
Frick!
Fights can be entertaining, right? Actually, both ways. Because of the conflict, but also you can use them in an entertaining way. We're going to see another entertaining fight in a minute. Realistic. You all know how to write realistic because you probably get in fights all the time with your brothers and your sisters, okay? So, we're not going to spend a ton of time on that. Realistic is accurate or true to life. Fantasy. Okay. Fantasies are fights that couldn't really happen in the real world. Probably because the fight includes some kind of magic. Okay? Some kind of power, something that doesn't exist in our world. So two wizards arguing over the last cookie is actually a realistic fight. But two wizards argue over the last cookie and one turns the other into a flatworm, you've now elevated that fight into a fantasy fight, okay? You can use all kinds of magic in a fantasy fight, but you must stay in your rules of your defined magic, your rules of your magic. For example, in some books you'll read that, especially if there's magic, magic's tricky, because it's like, well, if you're magic, then why can't you just resolve a conflict really fast, you know, just do a spell. So most books that deal with magic, you make some rules of magic, and there have been some other classes about that. And then you have to stay within those rules. Magic cannot be all powerful. It's just not fun, okay? There is this show that I love, but it totally I call it the misuse of Merlin's magic. And we're gonna watch a little bit, just a little blip, if any of you are familiar with the show, and then we're gonna talk a little bit about the problems with it. And then we're gonna talk about some good things the show does, because I love it.
Tell me. Don't think so. You have magic.
I was born with it.
Sometimes Merlin can heal the person who's sick, and sometimes he can't figure out how to do it, even though it's pretty much the same thing that happened 5 episodes ago. I love Merlin, though, but here's my main question for the producers. If Merlin is so powerful, why can't he kill Morgana? How many times does he try to kill Morgana? You're going to say because she has black magic, right?
No, his own morality does not allow him to do so.
Oh, that's a good point. That's a good point. But then he really gets to hate her, and he actually thinks he kills her a few times, but she keeps popping back up, right? And I think in the end, obviously, but as the story progresses, it gets a little, you think, why can't he kill her? They don't exactly stick within their rules of magic. That said, I love Merlin. So let's talk about something that Merlin does great, all right? Okay, that's a repeat. So follow rules when writing a fantasy battle. During a sword fight, especially like a one-on-one sword fight or one-on-many, you want to keep your dialogue to a minimum, okay? So let's watch a Merlin battle. Did you notice, what made that fight scene intense? Yes?
The intenseness was that there wasn't really much speaking involved. There was more action than words going on. The action spoke for itself.
The action spoke for itself. Yeah, excellent. Okay. Good one. Yes. Now, there is an exception to every rule, okay? This fight scene totally breaks that rule. But we're going to talk about why.
You are wonderful.
Thank you. I've worked hard to become so.
I admit it, you are better than I am.
Then why are you smiling?
Because I know something you don't know.
And what is that?
I am not left-handed.
You are amazing.
I ought to be after 20 years.
There's something I ought to tell you.
Tell me. I'm not left-handed either.
So, there is dialogue in that fight. How come it works? Dang, you're smart. She said not only is it a physical fight, it was a fight of words. I hadn't even thought of that. So, I agree. I think that is. That's an excellent point.
Let's try it.
Get it to the right person. All right, let's try one right here.
Well, the fact that in the princess bride, you knew from the start that this battle wasn't going to be normal. Inigo helped Wesley get up there.
Yes. So you knew from the get-go the fight wasn't going to be normal because the entire story of Princess Bride isn't normal. It is a satire. Okay? So make your fight scene or scenes match the genre of your book. If you're writing Princess Bride, you're not going to make a fight scene intense like you would find in Merlin. Okay? In a romance, there'll probably be a chivalrous fight. Maybe between two men fighting over a girl, okay? A Middle Earth fantasy book, it's gonna be an epic battle, okay? You're not gonna fight a silly satirical fight in the middle of a fantasy novel. So, the rule is not so much dialogue, but think about what is my genre, because you kind of have to tweak things, okay? All right. Make sure I'm doing good. All right, but we digress. Back to dialogue. How do I break up the action in a fight scene if I can't use dialogue? Because you don't want two pages of just the sword went up, the sword went down, he shuffled his feet, he turned around, someone whacked him in the head. It gets monotonous. Even though fight scenes are exciting, it can still get monotonous. So you need to include in a fight scene, you need to include what the character hears, what the character feels, tastes, sees, and smells. So in an epic battle, there might be the smell of blood, okay? There'll also be the feeling of fear, probably in almost any battle, all right? You've also got hearing, so for sure, in a big epic battle, you've got swords clashing, or if it's like sci-fi, you've got lasers zapping, okay? Let's see what else. Taste. What might the taste be? Like if they're fighting in a field, they can actually taste the dirt. Okay, that's good. Right there.
Like, they can, like, not exactly taste, but they can taste, like, how their mouth is, like, so dry.
I thought the same thing. Really thirsty, like your tongue sticking to something. Okay, hang on. One more. Right there. It tastes like sweat. Absolutely. They might be licking their armpits. Yeah, it could. Absolutely. And it makes it more intense. And it breaks up the description of the battle. And it really internalizes it. And it makes it so much more real if you add those things. Also, you want to include brief but frequent internal dialogue. Those are through thoughts or observations. So your character that you're following, that character is going to have some thoughts. Like, so the sword swings, and then your character is going to have not verbal dialogue, I mean, like external dialogue, but inside they're going to think, man, that was close. Okay, that's called internal dialogue. So we're going to take a little look into Miss Born, Brandon Sanders. He's awesome. We need to get him and Tina up at boot camp, don't we?
Yeah.
You do.
Yeah.
All right. This is from his Miss Born. And you know what's funny about this is my son and his friend were over, and I just handed the book, and I said, find a good battle. And it was so easy to open it and just find one, because it is full of good battles. All right. A startled guard stood not 3 paces away. Thank you. Kelsier, because I say it my own way, but I don't know if it's right. Kelsier was upon the man in a second, jumping into the air, pulling slightly on the guard's steel breastplate, and throwing the man off balance. Kelsier whipped out one of his glass daggers, allowing the strength of his iron pull to bring him toward the guard. He landed with both feet against the man's chest, then crouched and sliced with a pewter-enhanced swing. Kelsier left the guard to his gurgling demise. The man was likely a lesser nobleman, the enemy. If he were a scoff soldier, enticed into betraying his people in exchange for a few coins, well then, Kelsier was even happier to send such men into their eternity. So good. Huh. All right, so this is a little trickier. Where is the internal dialogue? Let's take a guess. Yes, even though it's not, like Brandon Sanderson didn't say, the man was likely a scoff soldier. He thought. All right, so he didn't even need to put a tag on that, okay? That's called a tag. But absolutely, that was internal dialogue. Pretty much that entire second paragraph. I put in red what I felt was the internal dialogue. That's how it works. You have some action, the first paragraph, and then you put a little bit of internal dialogue in there. All right, we're moving on to a one-on-one fight scene. Here we go. Do I want to say anything first?
It is now. Give me the scroll.
I would rather die.
Okay? It's even better if your main character is like the underdog, which actually Shifu is because he's older, right? And it made it pretty intense. Also what it does, since he has his opponent is so worthy, is because it's easy to believe that he doesn't win that fight. And it makes it more interesting. All your battles can't be like that. This is just maybe one of your battles, for, you know, depending on how many you've got.
Besides, Ellen is like, she's like,
she feels adopted son, so that makes things even more rough.
She said that Tai Lung, right? Is that how you say it? Is Shifu's adopted son, which makes it more intense. And that's actually the fourth point. We'll skip there. A villain who is connected to the characters is more compelling than some detached, random, creepy stalker dude who sits around planning evil battles. Okay? That's just not as engaging. But, you know, maybe, for example, you know, Voldemort was such an engaging villain or an engaging opponent for Dumbledore, yeah, because he was kind of like Dumbledore's protege, you know? Dumbledore went, found him, and brought him in, and tried to teach him, and then, of course, he turned on him, right? Oh, spoiler alert to Harry Potter. And then third of all, again, weakness can be attractive, all right? It makes you like your character more, it makes your readers like your character more, because they can relate to someone who's weak, because none of us are superheroes. So sometimes it's a little harder to relate to superheroes. But if you've got a character that has a weakness or two that makes them possibly lose a battle or two, we like them, and then we root for them even stronger the next time they get into conflict. All right, what about this one-on-one fight? We're going to take a quick look at it.
Katniss!
Hunger Games is more than just a one-on-one, but that particular scene was one-on-one. What happened? Yes?
Sometimes it is and you need your opponent, like maybe your opponent, in a way after you get back.
Didn't even think about it. Love it. Let me repeat that. Sometimes the main character is not the person that the opponent is after, but someone they love. And that almost makes it more, it's like a parent. I would rather have someone come after me than have them come after my kid, all right? Yes, back there.
You pretty much just said it. It's like, if the main character has the burden of protecting something or someone, it's like so much more easy to like them if they are, like, emotional towards something.
Yeah.
Like they're trying to destroy it.
That main character protecting someone in the battle. Like even Lord of the Rings, you know, it's in so many things. The main character protecting someone they love, and that ups the ante. Something else we learned about, and not necessarily just one-on-one scenes, but something else we learned about that scene that's important. When a character dies, you feel a lot of emotion, especially if you're attached. And Suzanne Collins did a fabulous job of attaching you to Rue in Hunger Games. Really, really good job. Okay, we're gonna move on. In fact, we're gonna talk a little bit about this. So best-selling author Stephen King said, "First, you create a real person and make the reader care. Then you massacre." It's accredited to Stephen King on the website I went to. Now, what is the effect of killing the minor character of Rue? We already talked a little bit about it, but let's see. Anyone else? A new hand? Yes. Yeah. It totally And let me put this, not every book is like this, but typically you kill off not your major character, okay? But if you kill off one of the minor characters, it totally makes your main character more human because they mourn and you see an emotional side of them. Okay, we're going to move on. I think we're going to move on. All right. So, what else can we learn from The Hunger Games? This is a portion out of Catching Fire, okay? I've never seen any animal move so fast. They slide down the vines as if the things were greased, leap impossible distances from tree to tree, fangs bared, hackles raised, claws shooting out like switchblades. Oops, forgot the period. Anyway, I know every arrow must count, and they do. In the eerie light, I bring down monkey and monkey. I think it's actually monkey after monkey. Sorry. Targeting eyes and hearts and throats, I feel claws on my leg, down my back, before someone takes out the attacker. The air grows heavy with trampled plants, the scent of blood, and the musty stink of the monkeys. First of all, she includes some what? Yeah, some of the details, the smelling and, you know, the feelings. Okay, what do you get from her writing? What do you notice about it? First, some new hands. Have you ever answered? Let's see. Right there. Take a guess. It's kind of hard to know what I'm getting at, too. He was stretching. Okay, yes. Do you know why? What is specific about her writing? She does something. Very purposefully. Yes. Sensory imaging. Yes. What else? Very end. And do you know how she does that? She writes in present tense. I'll quit bugging you guys. If you look at her verbs, I know. In a past tense book, which probably 90% of books are written in past tense, it would be, I knew every arrow had to count, and they did. In the eerie light, I brought down monkey after monkey. That is 90% of the books you read would be like that. In her book, she wanted to put you in the middle of the battle, intense, and so she writes it in present tense. And I've kind of found it fun. Most of my books I write in third person, but just for a challenge, I wrote one in not first person. Most of my books I write past tense, but for fun, I wrote one in present. And it's tricky, but it was a really good exercise as an author. She writes in present tense. That's why when you read those books, you get thrown into it. All right, fight scenes include, and she also does a few of these things, if you'll notice. Fight scenes, short sentences or phrases that create a frantic tempo. Let's take a look at those. Fangs bared, hackles raised, claws shooting out like switchblades. Those aren't necessarily sentences, but they're separated by commas. It makes them short phrases. It makes it quick, fast, intense. Longer sentences that slow down the pace and help keep the fighting in control, because you don't want a whole page of 5-word sentences. So she's got, so a little longer, an example of a longer sentence might be, they slide down the vines as if the things were greased, okay? That's still kind of a short sentence, but this is a really intense scene. All right, and in a fight scene, you have very limited use of flashbacks. That's something that as writers we tend to accidentally do, not meaning to. So like, they'll be fighting, and then all of a sudden we'll say, it reminded him of the time that he was down on the banks and an alligator came and tried to gnaw his leg and it hurt really bad and that's how bad his leg hurt. That's a little bit too much, okay? A little bit too much backstory or flashback. So you try to avoid those as much as possible. But not internal dialogue per se, okay? All right, a one on many fight scene. Take a look, this is short, but we're gonna learn a few things from it. Mission Impossible. It was fast and a little fuzzy, so you might not recognize. So one on many, okay? A little different than one on one. What makes it more complicated? Let's see. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. So it's a little trickier because you've got one fighting the one, and then you've got the many, and you have to keep everyone active, is what she said. You can't have three of them watching because that's not realistic and it's also boring, okay? So it's a little trickier. You've got to keep one plus maybe in this scene it was like four others busy. Yes, very, very, very far back in the gray blazer.
Well, one hard thing with one on many is not making your main character look like too much of a boss if you're trying to win.
He said not making your main character too much of a boss. I'm going to get you your treat later because I will fail ethically. There you go. Yes, we have another one up here.
It's almost, for the audience, it's almost hard to see where exactly he's going with his or her move. Like, you see him focusing on one character, then also he's on.
Yeah, and that's a really good point. That's what we're going to talk about a little bit. So, one on many, here's some lessons from Mission Impossible. You may have to choreograph your characters for moves. So, choreography is typically associated with, like, dances, okay? Now, you got your drill team, and they're doing their choreography. When you've got one on many, you have to start envisioning, okay, someone's here, he's got to get his arm over there, maybe kick back with his leg. You have to start making all of your main characters move count. Every single one has to be engaging an opponent, maybe even two opponents at the same time. And then take some choreography. All right, also, and this is from Mission Impossible. Unique setting may add to the success of a battle scene. What do you love about that scene, that one on many? It's the fact he's in this elevator, right? Confined, strapped, you're thinking he's hopeless. All right, and then you need to find balance between keeping the action going and giving the reader some details. So that's a little tricky for me, I find that tricky because you want to, like I said, keep it moving, but in your writing, you've got to give some of the details of that elevator, pushing the button and making it light up, okay? But you have to find a balance. Here we go, we're on to epic, an epic scale battle. Many on many. These are, no doubt about it, the very hardest to write. Stopped it before it got gory. Here we go, epic battles. Let's learn a little bit about them. Use many of the things we've already learned. So keep your dialogue short. Internal dialogue, so give it some thoughts. Give a weakness in your main character. Mix short and long sentences. These are more difficult to write because they are all encompassing, all right? It's just not one-on-one. You've got probably all of your main characters and all of your side characters involved. You've also most likely got some pretty intense scenery that you've got involved. You've got to kind of describe that. You've got choreography, like in the one-on-many, but it's only amplified. All right, intensity comes from the build-up to the battle, the fear of which characters will die, and the final outcome and what it means. So in an epic battle scene, this is what gives your readers, this is why your readers feel intense. First of all, the buildup. That scene we just watched, was the buildup not incredible? Did you notice something too? And you kind of, this was obviously done with the camera, but you can do it with your writing. You would see a bunch of the horses riding, and then you would see, or running. Then you would see like six of them, and then it would actually focus in on just one horse, okay? And then it pans back out again. All right, that's all encompassing. That's the trick to an epic battle scene. So the buildup, the fear of which characters will die. In an epic battle, you know you're losing somebody. Okay? If you write an epic battle and nobody dies, it's stupid, which is why Twilight, the last, doesn't work. There's like supposedly an epic battle and nothing happens. Okay, you gotta lose some characters. And then the final outcome, will good triumph over evil? And if so, will it triumph like how they want it to? Or is it gonna triumph in some other method? All right, another huge point with epic battles, you need to make a map. So on the left-hand side, you see J.R.R. Tolkien's map of Middle Earth. On the right side, you see Lois Brown's map of, it's a historical fiction from 1915. Okay, yeah, so someone's a little more talented than the other one. And that's why Tolkien's is now into a movie. But my point is, you may feel intimidated because maybe a lot of you have read Tolkien's or at least seen, you know, some of these really complicated detailed maps. You don't need a map like that because you waste all your time doing the map like that. Just scribble something out. I was writing this and I knew I had like a slot canyon and I knew I had a cave involved and I wanted to figure out how to get where, and so just sketching it out like that, and I actually didn't include all the things. This was a redo map because my first map I actually threw away. But when I was writing this class, I thought, oh, I should remake that map. You can make it simple, not a big deal, but you do need something to help you remind yourself. So, Tolkien's map, let's see what it turned out. Epic. Do you see how Tolkien had to have a vision in his head? When he's making these huge landscapes, and he's got a city over here, and the battleground, and two enormous armies, you need a map. You need to keep track of what you're doing. All right, things to consider on your map. Visualize the battlefield. Pinpoint the location of your combatants. Add landmarks that may turn into something important during the battle, like maybe a mountain or a slot canyon, okay? Geography, just like I said, look at the geography. Are there any unusual terrain features? So for example, is the ground rocky? Are people gonna be stumbling and falling? Or is it slippery? This is kind of a gross example, but have people been killed and blood spilled, and so you're kind of slipping on someone else's blood? You know, that's, so you think about the unusual terrain features. Are there bridges, waterways, buildings, castles? Lots of things to consider as you write an epic battle scene. All right, you need to show the effect once your epic battle scene is done. You need to take a look at each of your characters, both your protagonist and your other main characters, even though they're maybe minor. It's going to be bittersweet, okay?
We will live again in freedom in the garden of the Lord. We will walk behind the plowshare. We will put away the sword. Let chain will be broken and all men will have their reward.
That battle, that revolution, you look at those characters, and some it was victorious, for some it was bittersweet. He does a great job. All right, very last quote, we're done. I love this quote, and I'll tell you why. I'll read it. This is Tolkien. War must be, while we defend our lives against a destroyer who would never devour all. But I do not love the bright sword for its sharpness, nor the arrow for its swiftness, nor the warrior for his glory. I love only that which they defend. So if you want to make a good battle scene, it's not so much about the bloodshed, it's about what are they fighting for. Have a great day, you guys. It's been so fun.